Blackstone presents Doosra, The Other One, by Vish Dhamija. This book is read by Deepti Gupta. Doosra, aka Googly, is a term used in the game of cricket. It's a kind of bowling delivery that promises to go one way after the bounce, but goes the other. The primary reason most batsmen succumb to it is because they are misguided by the illusion that the bowler's arm creates. However, history is awash with batsmen who could look past that illusion by reading the seam on the ball. If any expert tells you differently, he is not adept enough. Remember, an illusion can only work till something eludes you. What you can see, you know. Prologue. Antwerp, April 2nd. Ron Jogani was ushered into the Aaron Diamonds with genuine courtesy. The light pat down by the jeweler's security was perfunctory. After all, he had been picked up by Aaron's personal chauffeur right from Brussels Airport's arrival lounge that very morning and driven straight to Antwerp. He had only arrived in Belgium at 0750 hours from Mumbai on Jet Airways flight 9W228. And unless he had surreptitiously arranged to pick up some ammunition or weapon from the immigration authorities themselves, there hadn't been any opportunity, as he hadn't stopped anywhere on the way or met anybody since. And the Indian airport authorities wouldn't have let him on board with any firearms, would they? They wouldn't have missed it either, as there had never been any security lapse on any flight that had taken off from India in over 50 years. Jogani wasn't here the first time or the last, and he wasn't a novitiate either to attempt a burglary. In fact, Jogani was one of the bigger players in the diamond trade that had been dominated for decades by Jewish and Indians, mainly of Gujarati ancestry, in Antwerp's diamond quarter. For someone in the diamond trade in India, a regular visit to Antwerp was sacramental. As such, Jogani had been here numerous times, but the purchase on this visit would be the biggest he had ever done. The diamonds were for a syndicate back in India. Instead of individually flying to buy the polished stones, they had entrusted Jogani to buy and courier for a few of them. This transaction could be in excess of 10 million euros, but it hinged on two dynamics. First, Aaron had to physically hold the inventory of the requisite stock. The specs had already been wired a month prior for Jogani to evaluate. And second, and more significantly, Aaron had to be willing to undervalue the rocks to save on import duties and let unaccounted money change hands. Aaron had tentatively agreed to the condition, but didn't want to discuss it any further on phone or online. The what and by how much was left open for negotiations. Jogani was, of course, of Gujarati descent, but his clan had lived in Mumbai for generations. He was a large man, stood 6'1" from the ground. He had recently celebrated his 50th birthday, and a bit of paunch had only started to make an appearance. He wasn't good-looking, no, but he was loaded, single. He was divorced at an early age and decided he was better off single given his predilections, and unapologetically promiscuous. Diamonds and women were his only two weaknesses. His biggest skill was his knowledge of precious stones, especially diamonds. Even with a naked eye, he could price a diamond, and he wouldn't be any more than 5% away from the real value. Oh, he knew his diamonds. It was for this very proficiency that he had been picked by the diamond merchants back home to carry out the transaction on their behalf in Antwerp. Jogani had been comfortable when his driver dropped him at Mumbai International Airport at midnight the previous day. He had had a couple of drinks and looked forward to some free scotch before the steward made his little bed in the premier cabin. So comfortable that he had missed some predatory eyes that had been watching him from the airport, all through the flight, and he being picked up and driven out of the Brussels airport to Antwerp. The sentience undoubtedly seemed lackadaisical, a consequence of having repeatedly done the exact job so often that it bred a false feeling of invincibility, the overconfidence. More notably, it almost tangibly heralded the carelessness to those watching and sinisterly lying in wait. His travel plans, his movements were being keenly tracked. But now, clad in Ralph jeans and a white polo, Jogani was shepherded into the vaulted office of Aaron Diamonds and made comfortable in cream leather chair across the large mahogany table, almost the size of an American pool table, inlaid with ivory and tortoise shell, an antique actually imported from India before the independence. It was apparent that Mr. Aaron did not fancy making his affluent client wait for long. He arrived the moment coffee was served. Leonard Aaron. The tall, slim.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.